presents this unabridged recording of The Village of Egg Graves, written by Seishi Yokomizo and read by Akira, Matsumoto. The Inhabitants of the Egg Graves. The Tajimi Family, The House of the East. Yozo, the head of the family. Kome and Kotake, Yozo's aunts, twins. Hisaya, Yozo's elder son. Haruyo, Yozo's daughter. The narrator's maternal family. Tsuruko, Tatsuya's mother. Ushimatsu Ikawa, Tsuruko's father, Tatsuya's grandfather, a cattle trader. The Satomura family. Shintaro, Yozo's nephew, a former soldier. Noriko, Shintaro's sister. The Nomura family, the House of the West. Shokichi, the head of the family. Miyako Mori, his sister-in-law, a widow. Clergy. Myōren, a nun from the convent at Koicha. Baiko, the abbess of the Keisho in monastery at Bankachi. Choe, a high priest from the Maruji temple. Eisen, his curate. Kōzen, a priest from the Renkōji temple. Doctors. Tsunemi Kuno, a doctor related to the Tajimi family. Shūhei Arai, a doctor, wartime evacuee. Prologue. The village of Eight Graves is perched amid the desolate mountains on the border of Tottori and Okayama prefectures. Naturally, arable land is scarce in these parts, and of what little there is, most is given over to a small handful of rice paddies dotted around, each measuring only 10, or at most 20 tsubo, or about 700 square feet. The inhospitable climate makes for a meager harvest, and no matter the calls to increase production, the rice paddies yield barely enough to feed the villagers. Nevertheless, owing to a wealth of other resources, the inhabitants there live in relative comfort. Charcoal making and cattle rearing are the main industries in Eight Graves. The latter is a recent phenomenon, but the former has been the village's chief livelihood for generations. The mountains that envelop the village stretch all the way to Tottori and are blanketed in various species of oak, blue, sawtooth, and jolcham. They grow in such abundance that the region has long been famed for its charcoal throughout the whole of Kansai. In more recent times, however, it is cattle rearing that has become the village's main source of revenue. The local breed, the chiaushi, serves just as well for working as it does for eating, and the cattle market at neighbouring Niimi attracts traders from far and wide. Each household in the village is charged with raising 5 or 6 head of cattle. They aren't the property of the village farmers, but that of the landowners, who give the farmers the calves and then sell them on when they are fully grown. The proceeds of the sale are then shared between the farmer and the landowner at a fixed rate. Thus, as in any agricultural village, the owners and the share farmers are pitted against one another. In such a modest settlement as this, there are stark differences in fortune. In Eight Graves, there are two wealthy houses, the Tajimis and the Nomuras. Since the Tajimi family is situated in the east of the village, they are known as the House of the East, while by the same stroke of reasoning, the Nomura family is known as the House of the West. But a mystery remains. The origin of the village's name. Inured to it across generations, those who have been born and laid their bones to rest there will scarcely have given a second thought to this bizarre name. But outsiders will wonder at hearing it for the first time. There must be a story there. they'll think. And indeed, a story there is, and a strange one. To tell it, we must go back some 380 years, all the way to the age of warring states. On 6 July in the year 1566, when the great daimyo Yoshihisa Amago capitulated to his enemy Motonari Mori and surrendered the Tsukiyama Castle, one of his young samurai refused to give himself up and fled the castle with 7 faithful retainers. Legend has it that in the hope of continuing their struggle another day, they saddled 3 horses with 3,000 tael of gold, and after enduring many hardships, fording rivers and crossing mountains, finally arrived at this very village. To begin with, the villagers received the 8 warriors hospitably enough. Put at ease by this reception and the villagers' simple ways, the warriors decided to stay in the village for a time, donning peasant clothes and even taking up charcoal making. Fortunately, the deep mountain terrain offered plenty of spots in which to take refuge, should the need ever arise. Because of limestone deposits throughout the area, there were caves, which also provided convenient hiding places. There were a great number of these caves and grottos down in the valley, some so deep and labyrinthine that no one had dared to explore their furthest reaches. If you ever were pursued, you could easily hide yourself away there. Doubtless it was precisely this geography that led the 8 warriors to decide to make the village their temporary abode. 6 months passed in peace and harmony, without any trouble between the villagers and the 8 samurai. Meanwhile, however, Mori's men had redoubled their efforts, for the leader of the fugitives was famous even in the Amago clan, and who knew what terrible calamity might yet come to pass if he were left alive to fight another day. At last, their search for the 8 men led them to these very mountains. The villagers sheltering the fugitives gradually began to fear for their own lives. Not only that, but the glittering reward offered by Mori's men was also enough to make them rethink their hospitality. What tempted the villagers most, however, was the 3,000 tael of gold that had supposedly been carried on horseback. If only they could kill the fugitives, every last one of them, then no one else would ever know about the gold. Even if Mori's men did happen to know about it, even if they were looking for it, all the villagers had to do was insist that they hadn't ever heard about it, let alone seen anything of the kind. There were many discussions about this, but eventually the day came when, having reached a consensus, the villagers took the 8 samurai by surprise. It happened when the men were in a hut, burning wood to make charcoal. The villagers surrounded it, and in order to block the men's escape, set fire to the dried grass on 3 sides. The youngest and strongest then burst into the hut, brandishing bamboo spears and hatchets ordinarily used for tree cutting. The era had been plagued by conflict, you see, and had instilled the art of warfare even in the peasantry. The samurai were caught off guard. They had trusted the villagers absolutely, and this unprovoked attack came like a bolt from the blue. There were no weapons in the little hut, of course, so they had to defend themselves as best they could with billhooks and axes. But the odds were stacked against them and it was a losing battle. One fell, then another, and another, until at last the tragic moment came when all 8 of them lay slain. The villagers decapitated every one of the bodies and with cries of triumph set fire to the hut. But according to the legend, those 8 severed heads wore an expression of such tremendous reproach that it made anyone who saw them shudder in fear. The leader of the 8 samurai above all retained the terrifying look he had worn as he lay there dying, hacked to pieces by the villagers and drowning in his own blood. With his last breath, he had cursed the village, vowing to visit his vengeance upon it for 7 generations to come. Although the heads secured for the villagers the promised bounty from the Mori clan, they were never able to find where the all-important 3,000 tael of gold had been hidden. They hunted for it high and low, in a frenzy, uprooting grass, boring through sheer rock, tearing up the valley, but never did they find so much as a speck of gold. Worse still, during their searches, a series of ominous events occurred. One man met his tragic end, trapped by a cave-in in the depths of a grotto. Another, while drilling the rock face, caused a landslide and lost his footing, falling to the bottom of a ravine, leaving him lame for the rest of his days. And a third man, who was digging the earth at the roots of a tree, was horribly crushed under the weight of the trunk that suddenly collapsed on top of him. Mysterious happenings such as these followed one after another, but what came next plunged the villagers into an abyss of terror. 6 months had passed since the massacre of the 8th samurai. Who can say why? But that year there were a great many thunderstorms in the region, bringing with them terrible bolts of lightning. Frightened, the villagers saw in this a sign of the 8 warriors' curse. One day, the lightning struck a cedar in the garden of Shōzaimon Tajimi, splitting the great tree in two with tremendous force, right down to its very roots. Now, the curious thing was that this Shōzaimon Tajimi had been the ringleader of the attack on the warriors, and since that day, he had been plagued by remorse and had begun to act strangely, tyrannizing his family and doing things that nobody in his right mind would do. Then the lightning struck the tree. He seized the sword lying nearby and struck dead several members of his own household. Then, running out into the street, one by one he felled every villager he came across, before finally taking refuge in the mountains, where he ended his life by self-decapitation. All in all, there were more than a dozen wounded, but exactly 7 had died by Shōzaimon's hand. Counting Shōzaimon himself, that made a grand total of 8 deaths, which, rightly or wrongly, the villagers fearfully interpreted as another act of retribution from those 8 warriors who had been murdered in cold blood. In order to appease their fury, the villagers decided to disinter the bodies of the 8 samurai, whom they had buried like dogs, and to re-enter them with all due ceremony, erecting 8 graves where they were venerated as divinities. Of course, it was this shrine in the hills behind the village that lent the place its current name. Such is the legend of the village of 8 graves, as it has been handed down since ancient times. But people do say that history repeats itself, and not without reason. In more recent times, there was a terrible event that was reported widely in all newspapers and brought the name of this desolate mountain village to the attention of the entire country. That incident in particular serves as the prelude to the strange series of events that are about to unfold. The incident in question took place in the 1920s, more than a quarter of a century ago. At the time, the head of the House of the East, that is, the Tajimi family, was a 36-year-old man called Yozo. Ever since Shōzaimon, a hereditary madness had been passed down through the generations of the family, and Yozo had been afflicted with it from childhood. Examples of his cruel and violent temperament were plentiful, and at the age of 20 he married a young girl by the name Okisa, and together they had 2 children. Having lost his parents at a young age, Yozo had been raised by his 2 aunts. When the incident took place, the Tajimi family comprised 6 members. In addition to Yozo and his wife, there was his 15-year-old son Hisaya, his 8-year-old daughter Hariyo, plus the 2 aforementioned aunts. The 2 aunts, twins and both old maids, had spent their lives, since the death of Yozo's parents, seeing to the affairs of the Tajimi family. While it is true that Yozo did have a younger sibling, this brother left the family early on in life to continue the line of succession in his mother's family, adopting the surname Satomura. 2 or 3 years before the incident took place, despite having a wife and children, Yozo suddenly developed an infatuation for the daughter of a local cattle trader. The 19-year-old girl had just left school and was working at the village post office. Her name was Tsuruko. Yozo being, as I've already mentioned, a man of violent inclinations, the passion that he conceived for the girl was intense. One day, as she was heading home from work, he blocked her way and abducted her, taking her to his storehouse, where he violated her and held her captive, subjecting her to the unremitting torments of his crazed desires. Of course, Tsuruko called for help with much crying and wailing. Astonished by what was happening, the two aunts and Yozo's wife tried to stop him, but their admonitions were stubbornly ignored. Tsuruko's parents were horrified when they eventually learned what had happened. Hastening to their daughter's aid with tears in their eyes, they begged Yozo to let her go, but he refused out of hand. No matter how much they implored him, his only reply was a defiant glare, which seemed to threaten further violence. In the end, the frightened individuals had no choice but to persuade Tsuruko to consent to being Yozo's mistress. Tsuruko was reluctant, but where might her refusal lead? After all, the key to the storehouse was in Yozo's possession, and he could come to satisfy his violent desires whenever he pleased. Tsuruko mulled the situation over. If those were her options, wouldn't it be better to consent and become Yozo's mistress? That way, she would be allowed out of the storehouse. And if she was allowed out, then surely she could find another way to escape. She resigned herself to this course of action and asked her parents to inform Yozo of her decision. Naturally, Yozo was overjoyed at the news. Tsuruko was immediately released from captivity and was provided with accommodation. Kimonos, hair ornaments, furniture, and every magnificent object imaginable were bestowed on her. But that was not all. These luxuries had their price. And so day and night, Yozo would steal into her house, lavishing caresses on her flesh. These visits struck terror in Tsuruko. Rumor had it that there was such a crazed ferocity to Yozo's passion that no ordinary woman could have endured it. Unable to go on, Tsuruko tried to run away several times, but on each occasion, Yozo would fly into a crazed fury. Terrified by his behavior, the villagers would beg Tsuruko to go back. And in the end...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.